welcome to worship on this, the day the Lord has made. Just a couple of announcements for us. The highlights kind of point to a blood drive coming up and the donation of some school supplies. Take a look at that. Please fill out the attendance pads that you find. And confirmation meeting coming up, just quite a few things coming up. The family camp in September. Lots of good information for us about things going on here at church. But we are here for worship, so let's take this time to stand and sing our opening hymn. Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God, our Father. We confess, gracious God, that we groan not only because of sin in the world, but our failure to trust you for all that we need. We have not waited patiently. We have demanded reasons from you. We have sought to excuse ourselves. Yet you have given us the Spirit who intercedes for us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us to hope. But in the resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ. The promises of God are sure. One day creation will be set free from corruption. Your sins were taken to Christ's cross, For you were redeemed as God's beloved children, as a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority. I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, so rule and govern our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that, ever mindful of your final judgment, we may be stirred up to holiness of living here and dwell with you in perfect joy hereafter. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
The Old Testament reading for the eighth Sunday after Pentecost is from Isaiah chapter 44. Thus says the Lord, the King of Israel and his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts, I am the first and I am the last. Besides me there is no God. Who is like me? Let him proclaim it. Let him declare and set it before me. Since I appointed an ancient people, let them declare what is to come and what will happen. Fear not, nor be afraid. Have I not told you from of old and declared it? And you are my witnesses. Is there a rock besides me? There is no rock. I know not any. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle is from Romans chapter 8. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to decay and obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation has been groaning together in the pains of childbirth until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope. For who hopes for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know what to pray for as we ought. But the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And he who searches hearts knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. This is the word of the Lord.
St. Matthew, the 13th chapter. Jesus put another parable before them, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a man who sowed good seed in his field. But while his men were sleeping, his enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and went away. So when the plants came up and bore grain, then the weeds appeared also. And the servants of the master of the house came and said to him, 'Master, did you not sow good seed in your field? How then does it have weeds?' He said to them, 'An enemy has done this.' So the servants said to him, 'Then do you want us to go and gather them?' But he said, 'No, lest in gathering the weeds you root up the wheat along with them. Let both grow together until the harvest. And at harvest time I will tell the reapers, gather the weeds first and bind them in bundles to be burned, but gather the wheat into my barn.' Then he left the crowds and went into the house, and his disciples came to him saying, 'Explain to us the parable of the weeds of the field.' He answered, 'The one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, and the good seed is the children of the kingdom. The weeds are the sons of the evil one, and the enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the close of the age, and the reapers are angels. Just as the weeds are gathered and burned with fire, so will it be at the close of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels, and they will gather out of his kingdom all causes of sin and all lawbreakers, and throw them into the fiery furnace. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. He who has ears, let him hear." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Thank you.
grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The text for the message this morning is from the epistle lesson recorded in the 8th chapter of Romans. And we're going to dive straight into some deep water. And we're going to take special note right from the beginning and focus a little bit on Paul's words that he uses to describe our time here on earth. Suffering, longing, futility, bondage, decay, groaning, pains. Sounds pretty depressing. It also sounds pretty accurate. Is that our expectation? Is that what you expect in this life? To be entangled daily in futility and sufferings and groanings? Well, there's no real reason to deny nor to sugarcoat what we all know is true. That these negativities, as we may label them, are realities of life. Life in a fallen world. But then the apostle uses one little word. One little word that covers this multitude of negativity. And that word is hope. Hope, or expectation, or confidence. He writes, "For in this hope we are saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it patiently. For in this hope we are saved." Hope, or expectation, or confidence. And we have to ask, hope in what? Well, he tells us, hope in the redemption of our bodies. Life can be a painful, frustrating groan fest. Paul was not immune. He was a follower of Christ. Look what it got him. Beatings, imprisonments, rejections. So easy to fall into despair. But we don't live in that world. We live in the world where Christ comes to redeem that which is fallen. Paul points us to that future blessing, especially that confident expectation, that hope of the redemption of our bodies. The ultimate blessed outcome of God's purpose for us all. So let's contrast that beautiful word hope with just one of the words that Paul used concerning life. That word of futility. In the Greek, it means without truth or without meaning. That doesn't mean that people are not looking for it. People in our world are on that constant lookout for meaning, for purpose, for truth. Something that is foundational. And that is admirable to have as a goal. But it's the starting point. The starting point that makes finding truth and meaning incredibly important for us to know. What is the starting point? Because it'll lead in one of two ways. It'll either lead to truth and meaning and purpose, or it will be an overall, over and again, stabbing in the dark. There's three real starting points on this quest for meaning. And this part of it is a little more visual, so The quest for truth is either here in the heart, it is here somewhere in our world, or it is there as we look up. So when that quest for meaning and truth starts inside, it can only start with our own personal thoughts, our whims, our desires. And that creates what we see all around us. A narcissistic world. One that forever is saying, hey, everybody, look at me. I remember that very thing. A young lady was starting her own cooking show. And the commercial that was supposed to get you to watch her, she said, I can't wait for you to get to know me. Narcissism. With the onset of Facebook and Twitter and all the other forms of social media out there, it's clear that people want to be heard. They want to be recognized. And they will declare something very strongly, publicly, and try to convince all of us that what they have to say or to show is critical for us to see and to hear. God says, you are trying to be me. You're trying to be the focal point of life that provides some kind of stability. But God says very clearly, who is like me? The answer is no one. And what happens when it's all turned inward? Futility. Without meaning. Without purpose. It is the height of futility to place one's hope in self, that which is destined to fall and to fail and to perish. Just follow your heart, right? Isn't that what we hear? Well, when that search for meaning starts with the heart, we remember the words of Jesus who said, out of the heart comes all manner of evil. Out of the heart comes evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false witness, and slander. If that is what Jesus himself says comes from our hearts, the hope that we seek cannot be found here. So if not here, then maybe somewhere in this horizontal plane we call the world. Surely someone who is strong and dynamic and confident and well-spoken will step forward to show us the way. And quite often, that person has a capital D or a capital R in front of their name, and they espouse themselves to be the one that you should be listening to. There was a man on the radio the other day who said that very thing. He actually used the word hope. He said, the only hope, speaking in terms of our country, the only hope is that you make sure you vote for, and he filled in the blank. Where does that point us? It points us to history, I think, where mankind has proven over and over again that that never sustains. It doesn't work. It is misplaced hope at best. Foolishness is what we should call it. Because the previous centuries have seen misplaced hope in kingdoms and leaders and movements and philosophical trends. And not one of them has endured to this day. That might lead us to ask, at what point do we give up hope? At one time, just as an example, as a young man, I had hope that the Detroit Lions will someday win a Super Bowl. I have given up hope. When hope is built on anything devised in the heart of man, when it is placed in anything on this horizontal plane, it is destined to fall because all of creation has fallen. Futility, without truth, without meaning. Sin takes away truth. It takes away meaning. Sin takes away Jesus. It sets him aside like some discarded, unnecessary relic from the past. But take note that when Jesus is, in fact, set aside, something or someone else will take his place. And whatever takes the place of Christ in our lives will always be less than what God has for us. And if it's less than what God has for us, we should ignore it, or at least pray for it. The stability comes in having Christ in the midst of this world, in the midst of a sinful heart. Because Scripture tells us that Jesus is the same yesterday and today and forever. He does not change. Our hope is built on nothing less than what God has for us, and that is the blood of Christ, his righteousness. The righteousness of Christ that is covering us in real hope. Hope that is built on the foundation of Christ's love for us. So we know that purpose and meaning is not here. It's not here. It is there. As we acknowledge that true hope comes from and proceeds from the heart of the Father. Because it is the heart of the Father that sends the Son. The one who comes in the midst of our futility and gives us hope. It is in the blood of Christ. It's there on the cross. It's there in that blood that turns us away from the self-centered life. It's there in the baptismal waters where we are connected to the death and resurrection of Christ, the redemption of our bodies and that blessed hope that Paul points us to. It's there in the body and blood of Jesus that we will receive this very day. And it's there in the midst of the sufferings. Because Paul tells us that the sufferings of this world are realities, but they are not worthy to compare with the glory that'll be revealed in us. And it is a glory that we wait for patiently because God is patient. Who wants all people to be saved, to come to that knowledge of the truth where futility now is set aside and Christ becomes the focus. As he is our life, our focus, and our Redeemer, may we live in that blessed hope. In the name of Jesus, our Savior, amen. Please stand. And we will join together now in our creedal statement based on the third article of the Apostles' Creed. In the third article of the Apostles' Creed, we confess our faith in the Holy Spirit who intercedes for us. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life of Christ. Amen. What does this mean? I believe that I cannot, by my own reason or strength, believe in Jesus Christ my Lord, or come to him. For the Holy Spirit has called me by the gospel, enlightened me with his gifts, sanctified and kept me in the true faith. In the same way, he calls gathers, enlightens, and sanctifies the whole Christian church on earth, and keeps it with Jesus Christ in the one true faith. In this Christian church, he daily and richly forgives all my sins and the sins of all believers. On the last day, he will raise me and all the dead and give eternal life to me and all believers in Christ. This is most certainly true. Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Redeemer and Lord of hosts, the future is in your hands. Remove all fear from us and keep us mindful that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed in us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O Lord of heaven and earth, we give thanks that your Son, Jesus Christ, died to redeem the world and to restore creation. Until that day when he comes again, lead us to care for your creation, not in wastefulness, but in wise and diligent use with thanksgiving. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, pour out the blessings of your Holy Spirit on the delegates who will assemble in convention this week for the LCMS. Give wisdom to those who propose, deliberate, and decide for the work and welfare of our Synod. Guard all who speak and all who listen, and bless the plans and actions, granting success according to your will. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And Lord, we give you thanks for all who serve as instruments of your compassion, those who care for the elderly at home, those who work in retirement and nursing facilities. Grant that we also may serve as your hands, feet, and voices to give comfort and company to the lonely. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O Lord, you are slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love. Be patient with those who do not repent and those who don't believe. Send your Holy Spirit to bring them into saving faith. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we commend to you all who endure the sufferings and weaknesses of both body and soul, naming before you this day Sydney, Peggy, Stephen, and Hilda. For David and Caleb, Harold, Donna, Vivian, Kay, and Lisa. For Nilza and Irvin, Tom, Renee, Leanne, and Betty. For Bobby Joe and Diana. For Eli and Greg, Jerry, Jose, and Tiffany. For Gwen and Mark, Robert, and Riley. For all those, Lord, that we also name before you silently in our hearts. Deliver them according to your will. Strengthen and preserve their faith, that they may rejoice that the present sufferings of this time are not worth comparing with the glory to be revealed. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Preserve us in hope for what we do not yet see. Grant that we would receive your holy supper with hearts free from pride, presumption, and any other sin that would profane Jesus' precious body and blood. May we rejoice in his bodily presence for our forgiveness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God, you have called us according to your purpose. You cause all things to work together for our good. Keep us safe until that day when you gather us with your saints into your eternal kingdom, which has no end, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, for you have created the world in which we live, worked faith in our hearts through the Holy Spirit, and given your Son, whose death and resurrection accomplished our salvation. Gathered in his name, we pray that you would strengthen our faith to endure in patient faith until that day when faith turns to sight and we are revealed as your holy, forgiven children. You have graciously given the Holy Spirit to intercede on our behalf, even when we do not know how to pray. Deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." And in the same way also, he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. O Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, in giving us your body and blood to eat and to drink, you lead us to remember and confess your holy cross and passion, your blessed death, your rest in the tomb, your resurrection from the dead, your ascension into heaven, and your coming for the final judgment. So remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us share with each other now that sign of God's peace.
Thank you.
The body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you steadfast in the true faith into life everlasting. Depart in God's peace. Amen. Let us pray. O God the Father, the fountain and source of all goodness, who in loving kindness sent your only begotten Son into the flesh, we thank you that for his sake you have given us pardon and peace in this sacrament. And we ask you not to forsake your children, but always to rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that we may be enabled constantly to serve you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace.